ended a document that says, here's the problems that we added last time. Here are suggestions of how to do it better. And it may be that some of it is happening, but not visible to me. And some things seem to be reinvented. Is that accurate? Like, or do you think that's not?
Do you want me to? Oh, I'll sort of,
yeah, why don't we do that?
So I think yes and no is probably the right answer, which is over the long scale, we haven't been that great about institutional memory. On some things, we are right not to do that. So, for example, we do not preserve lists of badly behaved referees. So when they behave badly the following year, we sort of don't know that they've done it previously. On the whole, I think not preserving such lists would be a mistake, and we don't do it largely through inertia, and we're okay there. I think it's changing as the scale of the job is changing. So we received a lot of really detailed and helpful information from past chairs, particularly René Bédard, particularly on timelines, on instructions given to referees and the like. And we passed that material on to others. Marcel Hébert and the ECCB 18 team are trapped in the intestines of CMT3. One of the mysteries of modern humanity is the corporation that employs the most HCI researchers on Earth is capable of producing interfaces with all sorts of glorious eccentricities. And that is complicating the thing. And they're planning to write up best practices documents about what happened to them and how you can avoid it in that. So I think that is developing. People who were ACs may remember my minutely detailed emails. Not everybody feels comfortable sending out things like that, but those are going to be passed on, and others will have access to them and can use them according to their taste. But I think we also need to respect that the community elects a conference organizing committee based on the community's perception of the competence and taste of that committee. And it is reasonable that committees should do things in slightly different ways. So while we can pass things on and offer resources, we cannot buy into future conferences. And we probably should not try.
I just wanted to ask a quick question regarding reviews and what you think about some sort of a reward system with people that write good reviews and a lot of reviews get some kind of reward in terms of, I don't know, registration, discount or something like that.
Others, or does that end with me, or does somebody else want to comment?
It has you written all over it.
Many bullets seem to. I don't think we could implement that in a way that was fair and helpful and productive. I see its merits, but I think the implementation might be very difficult. Some things one does out of a sense of duty and commitment to the community, and one recognizes that not everybody does it as well as one does it, and that's just life. We do try quite hard to acknowledge the contributions of our reviewers and the other volunteers that make this conference. And we particularly acknowledge reviewers. We've got outstanding reviewer awards, and we've got emergency reviewer names and the like. But it's never going to be a motivating reward.
I know this is something that NIPS is considering right now. Is that why you asked the question, maybe?
I do want to refer you to the list of outstanding reviewers and the list of emergency reviewers in the conference structure. We really do acknowledge these people. It's just difficult to do more than acknowledge and be proud of the contributions that people
It's also important to know that the ACs know who their reviewers are, and if somebody writes a bad review for me, I remember it, and if they write a review for me. I also remember it. So, you know, your reputation is actually going into your, I mean, your reviews are going into your reputation. So it's not that there's, even though you don't know what they know, there's a consequence to the quality of your reviews beyond how it affects the paper.
I actually think it's a good idea. I support the experiment that I'm thinking about running right now of giving registrations to the top 800 or so. I mean, it's a lot of people, because I think some of the talks mentioned, I think Bill Freeman's talk even was mentioning how, you know, you have to write your papers at different levels of granularity because, and then he slipped and said, you know, most reviewers will just look at the figures. That's not good, right? So I think we kind of have to, and people have been doing these experiments of, like, having two sets of reviewers and the outcome is completely different. And as the community scales, out a way to manage
kind of,
the quality of reviews.
I want to ask to all of you, do you think Victor is a good citizen, or how do we encourage them to be a better citizen?
Can you repeat your question?
Is Victor a good citizen, and how can we encourage them to be a better citizen?
Stop hiring senior contributors right now!
This is not. I should point out that I'm both an academic and an industry researcher. So. Okay. Should I really? We'll do this over beer.
So I think I do feel like this is a little bit of, this keeps coming up multiple times where industry, one, is treated like a blanket word that covers the whole variety of institutions and how they operate. And I do think they fall on many different points on the spectrum in these institutions. And two, there seems to be and I'm just going to be blunt about these things, but there seems to be an underlying assumption that people are joining industry just because you can make more. And so it's often portrayed as when academics join industry, it's because like they sold their soul, and there's all sorts of implications there that come about. And I feel like I need to push back. It would be ideal if someone who hasn't done this would push back, because that might just sound sort of hypocritical and trying to defend the choices that I've made. But so one, I think, similar to what Jitendra was saying, that I think of myself as both. I do still very actively engage my lab and students and advise them on all the projects that I'm doing, or in collaboration with my students. I don't have two different research agendas or anything like that. So in that sense, I think I'm still very much adopting both roles. I do think, like I said, going back to the original point of there being a variance. So the only place that I can talk about in some detail is the place that I have experienced, which is why I talk about Facebook AI research. And that is doing basic fundamental research that is not sort of pumping any money into. So earlier there was a question about, oh, you have these billion, and I think it was images from Instagram, and companies are not releasing that because it's in their financial incentive to not release it. My understanding is that the data set is not being released because of privacy concerns. There's nothing to do with the fact that it is a financial incentive. And so I don't even see a conflict. The FAIR is bringing in academics, it's helping students in these labs get access to resources. FAIR is also funding universities to be able to, it's a pipeline that's going in both ways. I know there's a lot of effort going on at FAIR in terms of trying to figure out a joint model that works well for universities and industry. And that's all I can add, because that's the only perspective I have. So if there are others who know of other models that other companies are following, we should definitely talk about those explicitly. So the conversation is not dominated by Facebook.
So I think, in fairness to my colleagues, I want to shade my slogan. I did, in fact, that slogan is a summary of a fairly detailed exposition of my position, which I made in an earlier talk. The point of senior academics is exposition and making PhD students. My slogan means it is a bad idea for anybody to stop them doing that. Right? hiring senior computer vision academics under circumstances such that they keep expanding and they keep making PhD students is fine. But what we need is people who know how to make PhD students who think. Why? Because if you inculcate good habits of thought in someone, they will last for 40 or 50 years. And we need people who know how to expand things, actually expand them. An awful lot of research is essentially pointless. And we don't want people being distracted from really valuable activities, like exposition and producing PhD students. If they continue to do it, and somebody else pays for it, that's great.
Okay, so now I have to.
Now I can't get the microphone.
Okay. So I have over my career produced 35 PhDs and 4 of them in this year. And in terms of my ability to expound or not, that I will end the community judge.
Sounds as though it's okay.
More and more papers are submitted, more and more reviewers. What do you think is initial reviewers. So things like, collection of papers together with a reviewer that's basically provided by the area chairs or by the PC and says, this is a good review because of this, or this is a bad review, not because it's a temper or anything, but just because it doesn't provide any useful feedback. So it would be better if you could expand on this. Like little things like that, do you think that would be valuable? And also, I guess, I'm very curious to hear your thoughts about what's the right entry point for someone to be a reviewer.
I can start with just a quick one, but it's not CD travel. I know for smaller conferences like PAC, Barry Bolt is telling me he's done things where he's taken on one extra reviewer who he knows is junior, maybe even the author from who submitted to the conference. Then a paper would have four reviewers instead of three, just to let that reviewer go through the process and do it actually personally give them feedback. Now that doesn't scale, that can be done at small conferences, but that's a nice entry point if we have more practice. That's something we think about. Now, I think David's comments on scale, that's where it gets really strange for things like CDPR.net. So I'll just make a comment on the smaller conferences where we can use that to kind of train people to start.
So I think David already alluded to sort of some kind of a training manual. I personally think that it would really, really make a big difference if we could have some previous reviews which could be made public in some form, right? It requires consent of both the author and the reviewer. But if we could work this out, because this is the kind of business where you sort of learn by example and you learn by apprenticeship. It's not necessarily the case that there are five necessary and sufficient conditions. I mean, we can try to articulate those, but really you can teach well by examples. It could even be that people like us who have more experience can prepare a talk on this topic and put it up on YouTube and require all the reviewers to just spend 1 hour listening through this. Because we have to train the reviewers because they are going to be junior people, we have no choice. Increasing the numbers doesn't necessarily work, right? So I saw that NIPS a couple of years ago, they decided that they would average more noisy sources, right, by getting six reviews. Based on the experience of my paper, I thought it was completely ridiculous and stupid. I think we in our community do a better job than that. But overall, we have to train the reviewers and we need to prepare the material and we need to take that on as high priority.
I have a question to all the speakers. The overall presentation. So this is my first time attending CVPR, and one of the best things is actually there are oral talks, very good, kind of like direct me to the paper that I want to read. But at the same time, there are some talks that are just a bit unclear, and I feel like it's only 70 oral opportunities on top of more than 3,000 papers. I feel like it's a great opportunity for speakers. Do you think there's some way to encourage the quality of this talk to be better?
I want to respond to that. I think the task of the reviewer is already extremely hard, and we're having trouble getting it done. Asking a reviewer to say, do you think the author is capable of giving a decent talk, is probably just too much. Papers become orals for a variety of different reasons. And I think the best we can do in a situation where there are so few slots is to allow people to make decisions of slightly different kinds. So different area chairs propose different kinds of papers for orals and recognize that some people, given the opportunity to present their papers, will think about it and practice and produce a good job, and others will not. The program chairs cannot take the speakers aside and basically make them do it again and again until they do it right. It's just they or their advisors or their mentors should be doing
that. I think I have two things to add to that. So one, I think that is partly the role of the spotlight talks, that are these 4 minute short orals, with the idea being that instead of them being just these 70 slots where people have the time to be up there and talk about their work, there's more of those just because there are more spotlights that we can fit. And I know just other things that we could potentially even consider not having long and all the talks can be shorter ones, so there are larger spots. And the other thing is, this was when you said that maybe there's something we can do to tell people how to give good talks. That was part of the motivation behind this panel. And so I'm interested in the talk about how to give a good talk. As if we do maybe a few more of these, the idea is to put this up online, as if it seems like these are good enough to be potential tutorials for others to follow. We could also just send these links out and have them on the CPR page, right next to where people submit papers, or when we send the decisions out, they know you're going to be giving a talk, and here are a few links that you could look at as guidelines to potentially give a more impactful talk than you could otherwise.
Maybe there could be an option to submit a talk with the paper or after it's accepted. I'm not sure that's correct, but you could, for example, give a spotlight with your once you accept it or during the rebuttal, or I don't know.
It's just like,
I'm not saying that's like the solution, but.
Lord Salisbury again. We are asking referees to do a great deal, and they're really trying. But we're not absolutely happy with what they're doing, and that's why we're talking about training. Asking them to do more is not wise. Somebody is going to have to look at those and say they're doing a good job.
Yeah. I mean, I should point out one of the reasons why those decisions are hard. So if the decision, the paper versus reject boundary, right, that, think of it, I mean, we are all trained in this business, right? So think of it as a process with some natural signal to noise ratio. You try to do the best you can, but there will always be noise, there will always be false positives, there will always be misses. If that decision is noisy, the decision of oral versus poster is even more noisy. And inherently, if you look at the numbers, you can see why it's just inevitable that there are going to be lots of false positives and misses. People get annoyed when they see a paper that's an oral and you think it's lousy and you think that your great paper, which should have been an oral, is not there, and so forth. But we just have to get past that stage. I think I do think that this is again something I've been pushing to the community without complete luck, which is that everybody, I think we should get to the point where everyone gets a spotlight. Now, it could be that some of those spotlights are actually presented in the conference, whereas the rest of the spotlights are merely there as links to a YouTube video from the CDF website. I think that that's something which is desirable, because I think the nature of the content that we have for people who are working on, say, something which is robotics-y or something which is video understanding, there are many kinds of material for which a live presentation is so much better than the written page, or it's a good complement to the written page. So, and given that this is 2018 and video material can be stored on YouTube and places like that, it would be great if we could find a way to give every author an opportunity to record a 4-minute thing which could be accessed in some way.
So, I would like to add to that, which is I think it would be good if the members of our community were to stop the pernicious practice of listing their papers as spotlights or orals on web pages or in their CVs. The decision to make a paper a spotlight or an oral is really hard and almost certainly made with minimal accuracy. Everybody does their best, but it doesn't mean they're right. Going around with a badge that says, I got an oral, is roughly equivalent with going around with a badge saying a bird flew over and I had to wash my it just isn't a decision that where people really accurately say this paper is more wonderful than others, because we cannot. So we should need to stop pretending.
So that's a slippery slope, though, right? Do you think the best paper awards are solid stickers, or should
people stop looking? Okay, so I'm in the position of being able to tease my good friend in more than once in one afternoon. It's rather a treat. I don't think they mean anything at all to his comments.
But I do think, Jitendra said this earlier today, the test of time.
Yeah.
It's over time. How many citations is the work they've done for work? So there's been many cases where we go back and look at the goals and they weren't excited. That's okay. It doesn't mean we're did have a very interesting conversation with some of the members of ICC, which would be Korea, and our Korean colleagues are a lot more tech savvy than we are here. And they were discussing, I don't know what happened, it was a discussion that instead of posters, we could have large LED displays. Because if you think about it, a poster really is a static spotlight. It's a spotlight where there's no moving things. And so you could imagine if we had an LED touchscreen donated by Microsoft. And have our own little spotlight, you know, our own presentations. It would be a bit noisy with 900 employees at once, but it's an idea.
Just a couple of quick things. So one is that there is a paper I just saw last night that Jabo Luo was one of the authors that was analyzing the quality of orals versus posters on several metrics. And they did find that orals tend to be higher quality because most of the orals are at least pretty good. While the posters, there's some that are super excellent, and then there's some that are not so good. And then the other is just that the people giving oral already have a tremendous incentive to do a good job on that. They're giving a talk in front of thousands of people, and if that doesn't motivate you to do a good job, then it's hard to say what else would. Also, if it's your first time, you may think some of the talks are not so good, but if you were coming 10 years ago,
actually, I have a question. If anybody here is also in the HCI community, in terms of, I had one paper in high, and I felt like they spent a lot of time helping me throughout the process, in the sense that, for example, between when you have camera ready, you have to tell them exactly what you changed, and they have to see that you actually, address the reviewer's concerns, and you have to have a list of like what you wrote, and then you can also have a 4-minute video and all sorts of stuff. So I'm not sure if people here are aware of any of that process, but I don't know if it would be good to learn.
The question is scale, right? I mean,
but Kai is huge, right? Kai is a pretty huge conference. It's not as big as
the media. SIGGRAPH does this as well. You have to be very clear. SIGGRAPH's a big conference. And so it just doesn't scale.
They have a lot fewer submissions.
They have about 500
submissions.
Right. So we have, I heard the. So I think this is really
good. I have a joke on scale. I think there are conferences in computer science, maybe, some of these programming language conferences, where the size of the conference is perhaps the size of our ADA chair meeting.
There was a conference going on at the site of the area chair meeting at the time, and the area chair meeting was there. Right. CDPR is this huge engine right now, and there are all sorts of weird things that happen as a result.
May I ask a question?
Please.
So I'll change the subject a little bit. I think hopefully people enjoy it. I'm also curious about how you shop in the poster manner. What is a good poster for you? How does it look like? And along the lines, Stantra presented, or maybe others, I would like to hear your opinion. What makes you like a poster? Because we know that presentation here is part of the success of the paper. What would be your suggestion in that line?
Are you talking about it from the point of view of the author or the audience?
We can actually do that, look at it from both perspectives. What would you like to see in a poster, or what would you suggest to an author?
Let me try and answer. I think the poster needs to have the visual materials necessary for the author to easily explain to people standing around what the key point of their activity was. So there are typically, this is what we're trying to do, and some examples, this is what we did, and this is what happened. And you want to be in a position where you can stand next to the person and you have a group of people around you, and they can very easily follow your explanation of the story. One of the things to notice is different people have different expository style, and as a result, poster styles vary. But you really want a poster that fits your expository style. The other thing you should notice is audiences vary. There are people who really enjoy one poster, loathe another poster. posters, and both posters have large audiences, and both audiences are happy. Right? So, you know, you want to find a style that works for you, but more than anything else, I think you want the poster to allow you to tell the story.
Can I also add something? Because I have presented a poster from CBPR 2012, and the last one was CBPR this year. And I have found myself adjusting the way of presenting a poster because the top of the audience has changed drastically. Back then, it was fewer people, more people that were actually had the deeper understanding of what we're doing. So it was much easier to motivate a problem that they understood the problem immediately, so you could go into deeper details. Now I find myself having to do a lot of explaining of the problem itself, which is not a bad thing, but I have done exactly that. So more visual, more examples, less deeper diving, and if somebody asks details, I will answer in person, although we'll direct them to the website.
Thank you. So, I love the idea of getting materials together to train reviewers. I think it's great. But it's also a bit like teaching a class by throwing a textbook at some students and giving them reviews. It's necessary that they get feedback for what they're doing. And the current system doesn't provide that. Are there any thoughts how you go about doing that, especially from the senior member of the committee?
Lord Salisbury again. I think if we train them, throwing a textbook at a class is better than pretending they don't need teaching. Yeah, that's good. I would be cautious about feedback mechanisms because they may be very inaccurate, they may be very difficult to organize, and they may just confuse everybody. You know, I don't think we could necessarily make things better like that.
After this, right after
What about having less
registration?
Each area chair and less papers, so the quality of the reviews might be not as important if there can be a feedback to reviews, ask more questions back to the reviewers by selecting more area chairs.
So it is a difficult balance. Be aware that there's a section of our community that does not like tremendous autonomy in the area chairs. So opinions about the powers of area chairs vary quite widely, and there are some who believe that area chairs should be bound by referees. Others believe that area chairs should basically do what they like, and the process you're describing will make some people happy and others not.
And in the draft of talks, there's been a number of mentions, very logically and sensibly, about following a consensus of the adopted procedure and follow the consensus of the community, for example, and the standard we should expect from things like that. Now we're expanding a lot of the community, how do we go about two questions? Firstly, how do we go about
So I'm going to give the bureaucratic answer because that seems like a job this afternoon. But the PAMI-TC is traditionally the vehicle for those things. PAMI-TC is binding opinions and motions in the PAMI-TC is what established the consensus and archive. As a result of a fairly lively dispute between people with very distinct opinions, and it's entirely plausible that that dispute could open up again and establish a distinct consensus. So recent PAMI-TC meetings haven't been all that disputatious. But that's probably just one of those accidents in history. And the consensus does change as a result of those meetings. They are worth attending because you get to see what your colleagues and potential colleagues think about issues like this. And if there is an issue that makes you mad, what you do is you get a motion on the agenda at the PAM-ETC and you fight it out. And that has worked.
Yeah. Yeah. Just a question, how many of your issues came to, first of all, how many of you were aware that the PAM-ETC makes decisions like this as a discussion? I'm just curious, how many of you were aware of that? Now you have to be very honest, how many of you actually attended the PAM-ETC? This field. So, I mean, it was, you know, we had 6,000 on the first day. The PAM-ETC this year was on the first day, it was a little bit unusual due to various things. We had on the first day 4,500 people register. The PAM-ETC was probably a little bit smaller, maybe by this size. It was about this size. So, if you want your voice heard, you vote. If you really want your voice heard, you come to the PAM-ETC and you make your voice heard. But if you don't make your voice heard, you don't vote, you don't complain about the consensus that you don't agree with.
Right. I think another thing that is worth understanding is our community is distinguished from many other research communities in that the PAM-ETC is very open. The process of placing motions on the agenda is very open. The fights are often lively and substantive, and the votes change things. There are many occasions where opinionated senior members of the community, myself included, I've been deeply distressed and disappointed by what the PAM-ETC does. What that means is it's a place where the collective voice is heard and by it. Right? It's not just like a sham of democracy or something. It really makes a difference. If you want it to do things, tell it to do them and persuade them it's a good thing.
So about the best paper awards, or honorable mention of the papers that receive awards, I have a suggestion. So instead of AC or program committee choosing one paper, you can nominate a couple of papers, 10 papers or so, that all people in all CVPR community can read and vote, and then you make a decision. I think that would be a much more reasonable way of selecting the best papers.
So, personally, I would like to adopt Kai's procedure of having the most highly ranked by some ranking K percent of the papers receive a class of award. Right? There has not been consensus behind that view in this community in the past, but if someone were to push it in PAM-ETC, I would be really happy to support it. One of the things to keep in mind is if you get 3,000 submissions, the best of those 3,000 submissions is probably a hell of a lot better than the best of 300 submissions. And there are probably in those 3,000 submissions rather a lot of really, really good papers. And if our paper pool is expanding, our pool of awarded papers should probably expand as well. So this percentage reasoning of Kai has always seemed rational and sensible to me. It has not been a point of consensus in PAM-ETC, which is why we can do it. But I'd love to do it, and I'd really love to have a motion and support in the TC on that.
Having best papers in different areas may be a good idea. There would be a lot of danger to having a popular vote, because the most popular areas would always get the vote, or if the authors are known, authors that are well known would be much more likely to win best paper. So it's important that the decision is made in a way that, as much as possible, doesn't bias it towards particular areas or particular form of authors.
I definitely agree with that because right now I'm seeing some of the process, and I'm seeing how there's so much bias that can be injected at every part of the process, like selecting AC, selecting reviewers, demographics of the reviewers, like what kind of grammatical error, just like there's so many things about each paper that even there's so much bias injected into it. And so, and then like in my talk, I was talking about how already, papers from well-known institutions are already overemphasized, and like papers from lesser well-known institutions are underemphasized, even when they have groundbreaking contributions, like some examples. So if you have a popular vote, then I think that's it's just going to be like a rich get richer kind of situation.
I realized it was really the wrong time to ask. I would like to rephrase what I just said, perhaps for a more Western view. What I'm sort of saying is this. If we ask a computer vision community, we call ourselves that. But the truth is our stakeholder is much bigger. Right? A lot of our funding actually comes from the government, comes from other sources. And it's not just today, right? They funded this community for many, many years when we were doing honestly things that couldn't work, could never sell anything. And it was those many, many years of funding that resulted in today's community. And even at the end of this, none of what we do, right, flows back to the original stakeholders and helped us. When maybe the bubble burst, maybe touch wood, think we go through another desert, how are we going to go back to tell people, hey, we need you to carry on funding us now? And my question is this, maybe we could do something so that the original stakeholders that put in, invested in this community, I know they are faceless, they are just taxpayers, but is there some way we can set up a system so that maybe in the bad years, you would be safer?
So, I want to make two comments. One is I'm referring to the Computer Vision Foundation, which is our rainy day fund. There will be a CDPR that fails, and the Computer Vision Foundation will step in and help. The other thing I want to point out is some percentage of the success of organizations like Facebook, Uber, Google, whatever, is attributable to the efforts of people in the building. Those organizations pay tax. They pay less than they should, and they pay it reluctantly, but they pay it. The taxpayers get rewards. Money is flowing back to government from what we did.
So,
accounting may be difficult, but it is flowing back.
So, to this I agree. To a certain extent, the money does flow back. But like what Professor Chitanka Mali said a long time ago, it's flowing back in a way that is very direct and it's very soft. Like it doesn't necessarily flow back to the original person, the original founder. Some taxpayers may get nothing. Some may get all. And the way it's structured, I feel like you'll meet that in bad times. It's going to be very hard for us to go back and say, you fund me. And it's also the same thing to the company, right? Sometimes the company does really great research, fantastic research. Invent the transistor, invent everything. But the company itself didn't get the money. And next time we go back, they will be like, why should we pay you?
Maybe we can take more of this offline and try and get to some more questions in from others, but we can take this more offline.
Questions?
So today you talked a lot about training and are you referring to review? But I wonder how do you keep maintaining the quality of reviews of those people who actually went to industry? Because in the industry there is like a between what the collection they do and the contribution they make because it just developed so fast. So how do you help those people to keep up the state of the arts and continue to do the work?
I don't think we quite fully understood the question. Could you restate the question again?
I'm just saying that a lot of PhDs now joining industry, and after you work with some applied problems for several years, it's difficult to keep up with what's going on with research in the last basically 3 years. And then when you do reviews, you have this kind of a big knowledge gap. So how do you help those people to keep track of what's going on and continue being good reviewers?
Yeah, I'm going to try and respond. I think some of my colleagues have been puzzled by the premise of the question because a great deal of research is being done in the industry right now. And there are many people in the industry who are at or close to or make the cutting edge in many areas. So regarding them as a little behind. behind the times is not an easy point of view to take. I think what we do about review quality from people who've been out for a little bit and want to come back, that kind of thing. One, I think, is we train them. I'm going back to sort of routine but important strategies. Train reviewers. The second, I think, is also important, is we really need expository materials. If you do not know what the state of computer vision is right now, turning up to CDPR for 3 days and going to every talk or poster you can is not going to enlighten you. There are too many complicated little twiddles, and there is no forest. There are lots of trees and no forest. It is very, very difficult to see what the state is.
Yeah, with that said, though, one thing that we do offer that I think was really popular here is a lot of tutorials. I mean, right now, the game tutorial has 800 people. So I really agree with David that we, as a community,
we try. It's just very, very hard.
But by the way, if you're an industry, don't feel bad. It's hard for all of us to keep up. I mean, with archive, you know, the half-life of these papers, you read one paper and it'll say the art, it's like, yeah, but in 2 seconds, there's another one on archive, so there's another state of the art. So don't feel like you're struggling. I think we're all struggling to keep up with what's happening. But I think your point's well taken.
So my question is about being able to extract the salient information from a reviewer. So the way that the review is structured right now is there's this question at the end that asks, what's your confidence level? And for me, every review I've ever seen is either very confident or confident. And I don't think that's actually very accurate. And I also think that just asking it all the way at the end makes people feel like they're being evaluated on their own expertise as a researcher. And so I'm just wondering, is there some way that we can modify the way that the question is asked to make it more like, do you think this paper is clear? How confident do you feel in that? Or do you feel like this is not? How confident do you feel in that? Or maybe not even say confident, say some other phrasing, where it just doesn't feel like a personal judgment and people feel more free to just, you know, actually answer honestly.
So I think generally there's probably not a lot of attention paid to how confident somebody says they are, because people are often confidently wrong. And I think as advice to an AC, I would say generally ignore all the bubbles until you've read all the words. And it's really the words that a review should speak for themselves. And if you read a review that does not have a lot to say, but they're a strong reject or a strong accept, then you really should not give that review much weight. Only, you know, pay attention to the reasons, the objective assessment, rather than the qualitative judgment of where it should fall in the boundary.
Want to add to my colleague's remarks. Over the years, if you follow CDPR review forms, multiple committees have engaged with writing different forms in different ways to try and improve the review process and the effectiveness of reviewing. It's always difficult. The best review is the narrative review, by a reviewer who understands the responsibilities of producing a narrative review. But you do need to compromise, because some reviewers don't really get that, and you need to be sure that they answer things. I think the many attempts to come up with somewhat different review forms have produced reviews that are about as good as one another. Right? It doesn't seem to have much effect on the process. I think we need training.
But just a follow-up, I think, you know, as a certain review chair many times, like I said, it's true, often you don't. And you have to understand, you know, often, as Derek said, we know who the reviewers are as area chair, so we often calibrate, because there are some reviewers who are borderline, it's like the best they're ever going to give in their life. And so you know that means the papers are really, really good, and there's some who love everything, and so it's hard. I think the area chairs do bear a lot of weight, and they tend to get the best training. It usually comes down to the program chairs. I think David was amazingly thorough this year, observing it. And it's a process.
So you were saying that each area chair calibrates, right? Is there a way to have some sort of institutional memory to calibrate reviewers, like average review something like this so to help future ACs and others?
So, as with many of these things, it's tough to get compliance. So one of the reasons the model of sexual harassment training at American universities is actually quite a good one, which is you would have a series of screens that the reviewer would have to go through. They would say something like, you know, here's a review, do you think it's good or bad? Which of the following reasons is it good? Which of the following reasons is it bad? You'd do that 10 times, and you'd have been through at least the basics of how not to make annoying, obvious errors, which is kind of important. I would actually like every reviewer to have to do that every time before every conference, which will drive senior reviewers to clean up the wall. But they're not that many. Why are they not that many? Because the community is being grown so damn fast that a danger I perceive, and I should have talked about it in the scale, is I think there is beginning to be a breakdown in the personal connections between ACs and reviewers that Mike described. They are an important guarantee of quality, but if you're dealing with about 2,000 individuals writing reviews, there is a good chance that area chairs will get many reviews from reviewers they don't understand. And then things become very difficult, because you look at them and you think, actually, I don't know who this person is, despite the fact you're trying to subvert the allocation system to get you people you know. So I think there is a breakdown coming.
I'm very curious to know about the sort of punishment to an extent for those who don't submit their reviews in time. Because I've heard that and send threats, what sort of powers does an AC have? Or is it who does not submit? This might be somewhat secret.
I am not willing to reveal the extent of my engagement with dark forces.
I think the biggest effect of you not being a very responsible reviewer is that the person that's the area chair can see you stops respecting you to some extent. And I think that is a pretty big contrast.
Yeah, and I think I want to emphasize that, I think especially for those who maybe haven't reviewed a lot of times, everything looks anonymous at your end. And so you just tend to assume that this is just this closed secretive world where no one can see anyone, but that's not the case at all. Area chairs have your name in front of them. When your reviews are late, they know exactly who's driving them crazy because of which they can't make any final decisions. And so I think that's important to keep in mind. You also end up noticing differences in how a person behaves in public and what they're doing when they're reviewers, when they think no one can see them. And that differential also affects sort of how much you might drop in terms of reputation in front of that area chair and others. You might, because you might have multiple area chairs for reviewing 10 papers, you are doing this to multiple people all at the same time. And so there is some realistic is that incentive punishment depending on you get.
Yeah, and just to make it clear to follow up, the area chair can see who the reviewers are, the area chair cannot see who the officers are. So I just want to make that clear. So it is true. Remember, it's a volunteer-based system, so there's not much I can do. If you don't do it, I can't stop volunteering. But we remember. But I agree, the institutional knowledge often doesn't get passed along. And David made it, I think, during your talk, you actually mentioned that it's kind of a problem with people. So if you don't turn your reviews in on time and your aspirations to be an area chair one day, it's probably not going to happen.
So I think also that dialectic of sin and punishment is not wholly appropriate here. We are dealing with volunteers. People are giving away their spare time, their technical time, whatever, to read papers and try and make judgments. The vast majority, the absolutely almost complete majority, are doing this out of benevolent motives, and they really are trying to help. They just might not be all that good at it, and the primary reason they're not all that good at it is they're not absolutely sure how to do it right. The number of people who are maliciously late, maliciously incompetent, whatever, as reviewers, is so tiny that it can be ignored. The main thing is to get the people who really are trying to help to do so as effectively as possible. And that, I think, is the better problem to get.
Thank you.
questions?
So my question is, what kind of suggestion would you give to students who are attending the conference for the first time? Basically, I mean undergrads and master's students.
Jen Wortman-Vaughn has a blog post that says things I wish I knew when I attended my first business conference. So I think that's very transferable to CDPR. I think that to the senior members of the community, I want to say, like, be friendly and welcoming to new members, because it's very daunting as a new student. You come and you, like, don't feel like you know anything. Everybody else seems like they know each other, you don't have any papers and things like this. But I recommend that you don't, so one of the things that Jen says, like, you don't have to go to every talk. You don't have to, go to every, like, session or whatever, but, I recommend that you talk to people, just like even random people that you meet and ask them about their research. I recommend that you try to approach, if there are specific people whose research you're interested in, try to approach them. Because I think the conference is very much a social activity, right? You meet people, there's a lot of informal conversations that happen. So that's my number one recommendation.
I'm following up. So what if I do have a paper, but I'm not quite...
That's good for you, if it's your first time.
Thank you. I'm not quite familiar with others doing the research personally. So.
Yeah, I think this is so for, like, I gave a talk earlier about how to not create a clique culture, and that's because I think it's on the community. Make sure that people who come here not as a big group or not as part of like very well-known institution or something like that to feel welcome. So I recommend that if there's a specific research area that you're interested in, like for example, that you don't know that much about it, I think the tutorials are a great place to go to, and I think workshops are really good to go to. I personally, when I first came to a conference, I felt very overwhelmed about all the talks and all the oral and things like this. But honestly, I would also recommend just venturing out to a random research, topic that sounds interesting that you don't know anything about, and just try to see if you can learn anything there too. But again, my number one, advice would be try to meet people. You don't have to know them or know about their research. Just try to meet new people and ask them about their research and their interests. Go to lunch with people, have coffee with people. That would be my number one recommendation.
Maybe some other things. So I think you mentioned that if you're not familiar with sort of the research details, so you might not follow every single detail of every talk or poster that you go to, but I think it's still useful to try and identify maybe themes that are there, sort of certain similar problems that are showing up over and over again. There's a whole bunch of papers on how to process point clouds, or there's a whole bunch of papers on this other topic, and just trying to get a sense for what are the problems that people are thinking about, what are the challenges that people are talking about. Even non-technical things about if you find a model to be particularly effective, then just trying to see what was it about the slides, what was it about the delivery that seemed to work well, and even making notes for yourself that. Is it when you have your logo, that's something that you can incorporate, and then what was something nice about the posters? Instead of picking off what these arbitrary things might be useful, even if you're not following the single technical detail.
And one thing, especially, I remember myself being the first time attending a conference. I remember feeling really intimidated and really stupid because I couldn't follow up on many ideas and even words. I want to say that up to this day, I still don't understand many. There's nothing wrong with you. It's more about how many papers you've read in this field, or how good the person that is presenting something is at giving the details. So don't feel intimidated, or don't feel that you're too dumb. That's not the case. Just for a big field, and there is a lot going on.
I think it's very hard to attend the conferences now. There's a lot of papers, but I guess my main suggestion is not related to papers. So my main suggestion would be try to have lunch or dinner with a different group every day. So even if you go to a poster and you like the poster, say, hey, can I join you for lunch? And just find a way. It's easier if you have other students in your group, then you can meet other students in other groups that way or other advisors. But it's something that takes some planning and something that, you know, you can't wait until 6 o'clock and then be like, oh, now I have to make dinner plans. But it's worth investing the planning to try to do that, because it's really when you spend, you know, half an hour or an hour with somebody that you have enough conversation that they can remember you and you can get meaningful, you know, make a meaningful connection with them.
I would just add, try to be involved in the community. I mean, like was mentioned, we had only a couple hundred people probably at the PAMAGC meeting. Out of all the voting, we had 500 people vote out of 6,000 people here. Volunteer to help out.
We accepted every student volunteer at the PAMAGC.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, volunteer as a student. That helps you get to know people, too, especially the more senior people. By helping out in the community and volunteering in whatever capacity you're able to.
You know, here, and I think I want to connect that to sort of a program of action. One of the things that people at this meeting on the other side of the table from me may want to think about is there were a variety of suggestions of getting reviewers to do this, getting people to do this, doing prizes, whatever. A smart thing to do is to formulate some of those information, stick them in the PAMAGC and find it out. Right? It would be good for you, it would be good for the PAMAGC, and it would be good for the community. The way we benefit is new ideas emerging about how things should be done to drive a consensus behind. And if you ignore the administrative meeting, then you're not going to drive that.
So as a graduate student, I have a concern about some tutorials that look like they are not actually tutorials, they're just some review of recent papers of some authors, of some of the organizers. So I don't really appreciate or maybe benefit from such tutorials.
The nice thing is you don't pay per tutorial. Your registration works for every one of them. You get up, walk out, and get someone else. I have never yet met a paper author who doesn't believe that their paper is rather better than everybody else's paper on the subject. And almost every giver of tutorials is going to say that, well, you know, the key actions in the discipline were the one I took. But if you find it annoying, there's another tutorial on the one side, there's another tutorial on the other side, go there instead.
That's what I actually did more than once, but I believe that a tutorial by the definition should have some low-level, maybe mid-level knowledge that can be offered to graduate students such as me.
It is very difficult to constrain the people who give tutorials, right? People will choose to behave in the ways they do, and experience tells that growing older doesn't necessarily cause the ego to shrink. I don't think there's any hope of constraining tutorial authors.
Yeah, just some more feedback. So, by the way, that's my student, so
I'm going to stop you before you go too far. One thing I do encourage all of you to do, since not all of you really, not many of you voted, is we will do a survey at the end of the conference. You'll be surprised. Last year we had 5,000 people, and at least I looked through every single comment we got. I read through everyone. The only thing I came away with is I don't know the secret to success or the secret to failure. Please, everyone. But I think we look at them. So that feedback, I mean, if you really give that feedback, we can feed it on to next year's tutorial chance. As David said, it's very hard for us to please. You know, when you do a tutorial proposal, you give a sketch, you don't look at your slides, we're not going to look at your slides. No one prepares slides until 5 minutes before they give a talk anyway. So, but it's well taken feedback. The other thing to keep in mind is tutorials are at different levels. And I think we could do a better job as a community to label if it was a, you know, introduction, mid-level, or high level. I know exactly what you're talking about. Okay. And the point's well taken. Thanks.
Questions?
No. Oh. Questions on that?
So this hasn't come up too much, but we often talk about how good papers are papers that can inspire others to do good work or sort of contributing to the scientific knowledge. And then there was talk about how the personal individual and the title are very important. And so all of that relies on the author having a reasonable command over English. And for those who are not native speakers, they have a significant disadvantage in that regard. And so I was wondering if you guys have any advice on how reviewers and editors should be dealing with that. So on one hand, if we are very stringent and know unless the paper makes complete sense, we're not going to let it in, and this is going to be huge systematic biases. On the other hand, if no one, many of the readers can't follow the paper, then it's not clear what the value of the paper should be. And I've often been in discussions with editors where both of these opinions are expressed, and they're both valid to some extent. But I was wondering what you guys think.
I was really struggling with this actually, reviewing papers, because like our community is growing and we want it to grow and we want it to not be homogeneous, we want it to be international. And for example, even within the Black AI, when I work in a workshop, there are great people doing great research, you know, but they're not used to maybe the format of the specific format of our that we were used to. Because you've seen a lot of papers, you've had a lot of training, and so how to disentangle these two things, and whether or not we should disentangle them, is a really good question. Actually, I don't know the answer, but I just think that we are at risk of systematically excluding a lot of good research because of the grammatical errors. And so I, for example, for for journals, I have, because we can give revisions then, and so like I've said, you know, like the ideas are sort of to understand English, and it was very, very clear that it was because they were not native English speakers. And so then they said, you know, okay, we have a recruiter out of France or native English speakers. And so I really don't know how to deal with this. I'd really like to hear.
So I'll comment. This is a gripe rather than a solution. I believe that in our community there is a persistent and unfair bias against people who write English in a way that signals that their first language is not English and that it comes from particular areas. Right? So it's not just a non-first language. There are geographic biases here as well. I think there's very good evidence of this. I don't know how to make it stop, but it's worth mentioning it. As a defensive strategy for an author, it is a very good idea to get somebody who has either cradle tongue command of English or close to cradle tongue command of English to go through your paper. But I really wish we did not have this unfairness, and I'm not aware of methods of ameliorating it. For myself, I know that for various students of mine who've come from the areas whose English style are affected by the prejudice, have written papers, had them rejected, and when I did a smoothing past cross-cutting purely on English style, not on organization and content or anything else, just purely style of use of language, the paper was accepted with enthusiastic reviews. And to me, that's an experiment. I've seen this often enough to believe that the bias is there. I just don't know how to get rid of it.
But isn't that, I mean, it's kind of hard that this could be solved by providing professional services which allow to like, at least fix some of the issues of the paper, not content issues, but like professional, but editors can actually do that. and it's a money thing. But again, Arma can't unlimited it right now. Has so much money, they could be like support for.
So I agree. Not to stop you early, but some conferences do this. If I'm not mistaken, SIGGRAPH does have. Now keep in mind, we have to submit it a month early. Okay, because it will need time, and I think a lot of us that's the bigger time constraint. But and as David mentioned, this would be a great motion to pass. If you did attend METC, they have a money issue. It was really interesting because we're in a really interesting situation where the METC, one of the problems we have now is how do we spend our money? So that was an excellent suggestion. But again, it has to be reached as a consensus, so I would think it would be a great motion. Reaches a consensus in the sense that we won't spend the money unless everyone votes on it and say that's something we're willing to spend the money on. But again, keep in mind, you have to have your paper ready a month in advance. So, we need some calendar time.
Yeah, that's the call to multiply that.
I think that's a good thing anyway, because I think that we should move away from this. I mean, it's like we're all doing it because everybody's, I say it for degrees, I feel like I have to do it anyway, but I feel like we have to move away from this last minute. Until the last minute, you know, experiments are coming in like 2 hours before, you know, reading that kind of stuff. So I don't think it's a bad thing that we would have to submit it. But I really support your idea, and if you want to work on a motion to pass it, I mean, so I don't know. But like, I would really support this because I think that this is one big way in which we can increase the diversity of.
So I don't want to be unreasonable, but I do think the first time I heard that anyone said we really need to get away from this last minute thing was in 1984 or 1985. And I've heard it very often since then. Nothing seems to have happened. So, you know,
pressure, you know. Yeah.
I think the copy edit thing is a good idea. I think though that it's a good idea to give a pass on a paper that has some quirks, but the content is clear. But I think it's still necessary to make sure that the content is clear as part of the evaluation.
So if we're writing about sort of collective concerns about referees, I'll add a gripe, which is I think many of our referees place more weight on novelty in a rather ill-considered way than makes sense. You have to remember that every really stupid idea is completely new. Right? Many ideas require long-term work, and saying that something isn't novel because it's a new attack or a different attack on an established problem is a mistake. Novelty is an overrated phenomenon.
I know at least now I'm reading the guidelines saying, you know, if it doesn't meet state of the art, you know, it still might be a good paper and things like this. But how do we incentivize the whole entire community to value it less, like the word novel? You know?
I'm going to again say training and formulating collective standards. I think many reviewers, you know, you've got 16 papers in front of you. It's 8 hours to the deadline. And you panic. And what we're going to do is to try and get rid of at least 10 of those 16 papers as fast as possible so you can concentrate on the others. So you make a quick pass through the pile, you identify the ones that need thought, set them aside in the hope that you'll get an extra 12 hours from the area chair in some way and you can do it tomorrow. And then you take the other ones and figure out some damn reason to get rid of them. And one such damn reason to get rid of them is it isn't novel. Doesn't mean anything, but at least it gets it out of your hair. I think that process, there's a giggling from the audience, which means I think that process of thought is familiar. And I think we just need to sort of discourage it by training and public statements of what we do and what we don't do.
Yeah, I saw a question about that mistakes and something a month earlier this year ago. passing a motion on it, but this student act that many of my friends do. Many of the Indian native speakers also are very excellent at English. And they just use a get access to their students, and a couple of my friends are already using it. So, and then you can still submit a paper on that as well if you want.
That's interesting. Just to be clear, I think the point was that if you want to get your paper edited, you would have to do it a month ahead of time, not all authors would have to just
spend Absolutely true.
And I haven't tried it. I know if I haven't tried it enough paper, though. I don't know if that's sort of sufficient to, like, when there's significant structural issues with the sentences, to the extent that it's even hard to tell exactly what, it's hard for a human to tell what the sentence is trying to say. I don't know if software would necessarily do it, but it's worth looking at these sort of basic low-level things or sort of all ways of using certain words and things like that.
Do you work for Grammarly? Can you just I agree. There are tools out there that help. Grammarly is a great one. It's very good, especially if you're from a country that doesn't have articles. So if your language doesn't use A, and Grammarly is very good at catching this. I'll be honest, I use it too. And I've worked in Asia so long that I can read things that don't have articles and I don't even catch it. And so I often write emails like that as well. And my students have never complained.
So coming back to the point of volunteering in CPR, so right now, like if you want to be a student volunteer in CPR, then the requirement is that you have to be a PhD student. So can we say that for a master's and kind of graduate student?
Yeah, again, this survey can give the feedback. I agree. So I think maybe it was a matter of one time we were resource limited, so we had to prioritize, so PhD students would get the priority. But there's a lot of discussions of being more inclusive. Excellent. I think a lot of things you see, you know, it's really it was a resource limit problem. We've seen right now, the good times won't last forever. It just can't. Just as I really like your slides, you know, in 2063, the entire world will be a single government.
U.S. population.
The U.S. population. Sorry, well, to Americans, that's the whole world. So, but it's an interesting thing. So put it as a motion or even as a feedback. A lot of those type of decisions don't require a motion. The general chairs and program chairs can collect it. That particular organizing committee can make the decision.
The website for student volunteer. I think a master's student and for the past 2 years at Campus Arabia on student volunteership. So master's students are eligible for it. And the website says any student, undergraduate or graduate, who hasn't officially received a PhD is eligible to volunteer. So I have come to make an assessment.
Great, so problems are
solved. I have a follow-up question to the previous edition of submitting 1 month earlier to those who are not correct. Isn't that again introducing a systematic disadvantage because they get 1 month of 1 month less of time?
Yeah, I agree with I like the word David uses a lot, squishy. These things are squishy. So, I mean, we can't solve all the problems. So I use a month as an example. I'm just letting you know, copy editing takes time. The shorter duration, the more you have to pay. You never use a copy editor. So, I mean, you have to give something. If you want a free service, you can't say, I want a free service to people before I submit. So I do agree with the systematic bias, but again, this is time planning. If you know that's your limitation, then you should time plan for it. So I think it would be fair here. We can't solve all the problems. We try our best, think we're a community that cares. We try, we listen, we adopt, but you know, don't expect it. Just be honest.
It's not two equal parties are going to be planning pretty well. The one that has to have a copy of it still has a class.
Well,
it's squishy.
It's true. So you may want to repeat the question either. The question is, it is an unfair bias. And the fact that you know, for whatever reason, English became a scientific language. It is unfair bias. I would imagine that we all have to speak Chinese. We have to learn Chinese. We would be in the same situation. Some of us are not being bias.
But to some extent, it is a time management issue in the sense that that person now has a month extra for the next deadline because they can get started right away once they submit their paper and they're done. So,
touché.
A better way to do it, well, and again, we have unlimited resources, would be that every paper would go through some sort of copy editing, and that would increase the quality of papers in general, because there are papers like on ISIS still on archive and stuff with type
disagree. I think it's most important that our papers be correct, that they make interesting and substantive scientific points that others should follow. If they are poorly written, we do have to accept that some people write badly. Some people are inarticulate. Merely being inarticulate should not disadvantage you if you have something important to say. And, you know, badly written papers may be very, very interesting. So I'm very cautious about requiring everything to be polished in language.
Maybe that can be the last question, something that I'm okay staying ready, so that's just a
I want to ask something to Larry's comment. So maybe English might be hard, but I think my main question will be what can behaviors do to actually make sure that that's not the issue? And I'll say not from the like native English, but from the native computer vision researcher. Because as I remembered, every three paper, when I try to read them, it threw more completely. Because it didn't fit to the style that we 99% of CPR papers have. It didn't have teaser figure, it didn't have a very specific structure. But at the time, that's why I read the paper, it was really good. Then, like for a few of them, after they got published, I saw them, they were from like different departments, different communities. But the question is like, what can you make sure that they're not biased in them?
So I will give you my own discipline for doing this, but your knowledge may vary. I always read papers, whether for review or, you know, in retrospect or out of interest or whatever, with a single slogan in mind. Those of you who object to my forceful language will probably just have to object. And the slogan is, why is this 9 past 9 to me? Now, the advantage of that slogan is it forces you to inspect the arguments, to understand whether you think they work, and to disregard things like they put semicolons in odd places, or they don't know how articles work, or anything else. Because a skillful liar could conceal the lie behind grammatical imperfection. Right? I think you really want to approach the paper, but with a view that says the author is trying to deceive you, and then come to the conclusion that they are not. Because it forces you to engage with the actual intellectual content of the paper, to try and prove it wrong. But I think, you know, everybody has a different process. But you need a discipline or process that compels you to engage with what is actually there and ignore superficial matters.
So before we let our panelists go, I was thinking in the panel session, we have a summarization list or a distribution list. But if you had to have like one message from people who are not,
manager time. Managing well, it works. It works. It makes a huge difference. And I'm open to talking to any of you to whatever lens you'd like about that, because that's something I really care about and it's made a huge difference in how I operate.
Be friendly, don't be competitive, and be open.
Yeah, welcome everyone.
This is nothing to do with my talk, I guess, but I would say do volunteer for something, whether it's your viewing or being part of the conference, but make sure that you do it really well. So commit yourself, but don't overcommit yourself.
Basically what they said, be friendly, welcoming, don't be too clicky, try to meet new people.
As a community, we need procedures. We need training of referees, and we need exposition. And those should be our big three goals.
And with that, we're done. Thank you all for coming. As a point of all these things.